Dear trainers, this is Sanjogita from Commonwealth Educational Media Center for Asia. I wanted to talk to you regarding your jobs. I wanted to ask all of you a very simple question. What do you think is your work? What are you doing? Who are you professionally? Some of you think that you are probably an overworked employee being exploited by your employer. Some of you think that you are doing a regular job in a private firm. Some of you think that you are a vocational trainer and your work is to impart training. And some of you think that you are a trainer and a counselor and your work is to help rural youth. Now let me narrate a story to you. Once upon a time, a king was building a huge temple in his empire. So he decided to check how the work was progressing and how his men were doing. So he changed his getup so that no one could recognize him and landed at the temple site. There were 3 bricklayers, and the king asked each one of them what they were doing. The first man answered grumpily, "Are you blind? Can't you see? I am laying bricks." The second man replied curtly, "I am putting up a wall." But the third man said enthusiastically and with pride, "I am building a temple, the abode of God." Now, there are a lot of hidden lessons in this story, but the most important one that I want you to reflect upon is your perception of your work. What do you think your work truly is, and how significant is it? Did you aspire to be a vocational trainer when you were in school or college? Most probably not. Most probably you are doing this job by chance and not by choice. Maybe you are preparing for a competitive exam, or maybe you have some other reason. Nevertheless, the job that you are in is not a simple job. Do you know that you are actually building the nation? Yes, you are not just a teacher, trainer, or a counselor. You are partnering in building India. Are you wondering how? Now let me explain this to you. India is at an extremely critical juncture of its development, which can make or break its future. Have you heard of the expression called the demographic dividend? Now, what does this demographic dividend mean? In India, the share of the population that is in the age group eligible to work is larger than the share that is in the age group of non-working. That means majority of the people are in the age group of 15 to 64 where a person is expected to work, and lesser number of people are in the age group of below 15 or younger and 64 or older. It means that there are more breadwinners than dependent people like children and old people. The youth is in majority, the generation that is ready to earn its living, generate economic progress in the country, that is in abundance. Now, this scenario happens in a country only once in its lifetime. Only once in the lifetime of India, such a time has arrived. India is a youthful nation today with a huge supply of people. As it is, our population is large. On top of that, the women of this generation are also most likely to work since they are educated and have been brought up in nuclear families. So this point in the life of India can be an opportunity or a threat. If India capitalizes on it and takes advantage of this situation, then India can move from being a developing nation to a developed nation, and that will be called reaping the demographic dividend. But if India fails to do so, the population in India can become a demographic disaster. So to save India from disaster and to reap the demographic dividend, what to do? We need to make sure that people in the age group of working, and especially women, are all equipped enough to be able to do something. Now, what is that thing that they require? They require skills. And not only technical skills, but generic employability skills. That means ability to just keep a job at the first place, or to become entrepreneurs, or to become self-employed. The West Europe and Japan are already aging, and their total populations have been declining. China is at the end of its demographic dividend, And although its GDP has grown at a rate unprecedented in human history, and they have succeeded in reducing the number of poor at the same time. However, they are already complaining that Europe became rich before they became old, but we have become old without having become rich. If we do not get our act together, then India will face the same challenge in the next 25 years. We therefore need to grow at a very fast rate, which is possible only when our youth are educated and armed with skills which can transform the society in an ever-changing technology-driven age. According to an analysis done by the US Department of Labor and Boston Consulting Group, there will be skilled manpower shortage of 56.5 million by 2020, while India will have a surplus of about 47 million. India will therefore have to concentrate on quality-driven vocational education and training system, which can not only meet its own domestic requirement fully, but also can become the supplier of skilled manpower to the rest of the aging and aged world. Otherwise, 25 years down the line, we will also lament that we became old without having become rich. Do you now understand how important it is for youth of India to be economically productive? That they can be only when they are sufficiently skilled to either find employment or self-employment. And who do you think is enabling him or her to become economically productive? It is none other than you. From today onwards, please bear in mind that your job is not to impart classes. Your job is not to simply engage students. Your job is to make the youth of India economically productive. It is a job worth taking pride in, and it certainly means a lot of responsibility. That is why we have designed this course especially for you, so that you can understand your responsibilities better and impart your duties in building this nation. Thank you.